am so glad I learned to trust Him. Precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that He is with me, will be with me till the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him.
Send out your light and your truth, that they may lead me to your holy hill and to your dwelling place. Dearly beloved, we have come together here in the presence of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, to set forth His praise, to hear His holy word, and to ask for ourselves and on behalf of others those things that are necessary for our life and our salvation. And so that we may prepare ourselves in heart and mind to worship, let us kneel in silence and with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by His infinite goodness and mercy. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against You in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved You with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of Your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in Your will and walk in Your ways to the glory of Your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia. Please join me in saying together the Jubilate. Be joyful in the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his presence with a song. Know this, the Lord himself is God. He himself has made us and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and call upon his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, his faithfulness endures from age to age.
The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 119. Your decrees are wonderful, therefore I obey them with all my heart. When your word goes forth, it gives light, it gives understanding to the simple. I open my mouth and pant. I long for your commandments. Turn to me in mercy, as you always do to those who love your name. Steady my footsteps in your word. Let no iniquity have dominion over me. Rescue me from those who oppress me, and I will keep your commandments. Let your countenance shine upon your servant, and teach me your statutes. My eyes shed streams of tears because people do not keep your law. A reading from the book of Kings. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask what I should give you." And Solomon said, "You have shown great and steadfast love to your servant, my father David, because he walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart toward you. And you have kept him for this great and steadfast love, and have given him a son to sit on his throne today. And now, O my Lord God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David, although I am only a little child. I do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of your people whom you have chosen, a great people, so numerous they cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, able to discern between good and evil, for who can govern this, your great people? It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this. God said to him, because you have asked this, and have not asked for yourself long life or riches or the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, I now do according to your word. Indeed, I give you a wise and discerning mind. No one like you has been before you, and no one like you shall arise after you. The word of the Lord.
Please join together as we say the second song of Isaiah. Seek the Lord while he wills to be found. Call upon him when he draws near. Let the wicked forsake their ways, and the evil ones their thoughts. And let them turn to the Lord, and he will have compassion, and to our God, for he will richly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor your ways my ways, said the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as rain and snow fall from the heavens, and return not again, but water the earth, bringing forth life and giving growth, seed for growing and bread for eating, so is my word that goes forth from my mouth, and it will not return empty to me, but it will accomplish that which I have purposed, and prosper in that for which I sent it.
A reading from the book of Romans. The Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought, but that very Spirit intercedes and sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to his image of his Son, to the image of his Son, in order that he might be firstborn within a large family. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own Son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus, who died for us, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
From the Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus put before the crowds another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all the seeds, but when it has grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid, and then in his joy goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So will it be at the end of the age. The angels will come and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. Here ends the reading. In the name of the Holy Trinity, one God. Someone years ago gave Rob and me a lovely little gift, a handwritten Bible verse, about 5 by 7 inches, matted in cornflower blue. It was wrapped in plastic and ready for framing. We never framed it. I'm not sure why. The truth is, we never even took the plastic off. I hung it, as is, in our laundry room, for some reason. And I put a little tape on the back and pasted it to the wall, over the deep welled sink there. And there it stayed. I had nothing against this Bible verse, at least I didn't think so. I was not judging how it fit into my decor. I just decided to put it there. It seemed like a good enough place. The plastic kept it safe from the dampness of the hand washing. It said, we know that all things work together for good, for those who love God. It's what we read in our epistle today. I say I had nothing against this verse, but I'll admit, I wasn't sure how St. Paul, in writing this epistle to the Romans, could be so sure of his conviction that all things work together for good to those who love God. It sure doesn't seem that way sometimes. Take right now, for example, during the pandemic. I'm not sure all things seem to be working together. For Paul, though, this statement was no idealistic thing. It was no flowery idea. He was not trying to impress the Romans with fancy rhetoric. Well, maybe just a bit. But Paul was actually speaking to his own scary and transformative experience of God. No doubt you remember his story. There once was a man named Saul. He was a devout Jewish man from a city called Tarsus in the country we now know as Turkey. Tarsus was a university city on the Mediterranean Sea and a city central to much of the world's trade. As a young man, Saul went to Jerusalem to study. He studied Torah religiously under one of the most well-renowned rabbis of his time, Gamaliel. Saul, I think you know, was also called Paul at times. Saul is his Hebrew name, and Paul is his name in Latin. This is the language of Rome. Paul studied. He studied Stoic philosophy, and he was an artisan. He knew the craft of tent making. He was a man of many talents and of much knowledge. But most proudly, Paul called himself a Pharisee of Pharisees, telling how dedicated he was to knowing and following the law. Early Christian converts, of course, feared this man, this Saul. He worked for Rome. His job was to root out and persecute those who followed the way of Christ. Saul was ravaging the early church members, entering house after house and dragging off people, putting them in prison. The book of Acts tells us Paul breathed threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any who belonged to the way of Christ, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Just imagine what we think about Saul if he were alive today, a Jewish man sent out by governing authorities to kill Christians. Yet, as we know, God chose to love Saul and use him for good. "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" The risen Christ confronts Saul. And from that encounter, Saul is temporarily blinded, struck blind. He later made friends with the disciples, and then he began to witness to Jesus as the Messiah. "I used to kill and imprison Christians." This is where Saul's emotion comes from. When he writes his epistle to the Romans, "Nothing," Paul says, expressing his soulful regret at all the things that he had done, "nothing can separate us from the love of God. God chose me, a murderer," he says. "How can that be? And yet, here I am. Christ came to me and altered my direction. Christ changed my heart to love. So I know with all my being that all things work together for good to them that love God." If you've been tuning in to church lately and then paying attention, you'll know that for 2 weeks in a row, we've heard Matthew tell Jesus parables about weeping and gnashing of teeth, the parables of the kingdom. Last week, we talked about the wheats and the tares. You can find this sermon on the website if you missed it. Matthew has a whole string of short parables about the kingdom today, following up on last week's. Jesus is continuing to explain to his disciples what the kingdom of heaven is like. "The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone sowed," he says, "and like yeast that a woman mixed in with flour. It is like a treasure buried in a field which someone found and then hid and then sold all he had to buy the field. The kingdom is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, and like a net thrown into the sea that caught all kinds of fish." There is so much imagery here. Maybe one of these ideas, one of these pictures, is your favorite image. But it strikes me that Jesus means for us to think about all of these and imagine them all somehow together. You see, when Jesus says the kingdom, he's not really speaking of a place at all. It's actually a dynamic, a revolutionary force. It's an active thing. Perhaps instead of the words kingdom of heaven, which seems to us like a fixed residence, a clearer translation is the reign of God. Some Bibles use this language. The reign of God, or the reign of heaven, is like a seed that someone sowed, like yeast that a woman kneaded, and so on. In telling this way, Jesus is sending a subtle and a subversive message about how working for God's kingdom changes the world as we know it. Jesus knows the mustard seed doesn't actually grow into a big tree. He's using parody or caricature. The mustard plant is a shrub, and a scrubby one at that. It's not welcome in most fields. It is invasive. Like mint, you know, if you've ever grown mint in your garden, you know what it does, it takes over. The mustard plant is like that. What we're to see in this image is that the reign of God is so persistent, it needs only a small start, a small seed. God's love is so obstinate and tenacious, hard to root out once it's found. In God's reign, many are able to finally hear the message and find a home. Likewise, once yeast is mixed into the dough, there's no getting it out. It's a living agent. It reproduces and greatly expands a mass. The kingdom is like this. It grows inside. It grows inside of us. It grows inside of the world and uses it for good. You know, Paul never met Jesus during his life. He never heard Jesus tell a parable. He never saw Jesus heal anyone. Paul had to learn all about Jesus' work and teaching from other people. The Gospels hadn't even been written when Paul began his ministry. Paul wrote all of his epistles before Mark and Matthew and Luke and John picked up their pens. Yet, we get so much of our theology, our understanding of God from Paul, from his avid and sometimes rabid faith. Why is this? Because Paul let the yeast inside of him, and from that, he sowed the seed of Christianity, sharing the message of God's kingdom with so many, with Gentiles, with so many people, so that they could find a home of faith. Paul experienced the courageous and transforming love of God. Courageous. Who but God would choose one such as this? Transforming. Who but God has the power to change one as such as this? You know, now that I think about it, I think that little Bible verse hung over my sink in my laundry room worked on me over the years, helping me to understand that all things do work together for good, and helping me understand that it doesn't mean, this little verse does not mean that if you love God, everything will work out hunky-dory in this life, that you'll live life in the lap of luxury. That's not what happened to Paul. He was in prison off and on for years during his ministry. And according to the letters of the early church fathers, Paul met his end in brutal martyrdom. No, all things work together for good to them that love God means that when you love God faithfully, fully, you cannot help but be changed for good. God works on us. God changed Paul from persecutor to apostle. When we open ourselves to God's love, we become that sower who sows seed everywhere, or the yeast that expands the kingdom. We become pesky mustard seeds, helping others to find a faith home. It's hard to get rid of us. All things work together for good means no matter what comes, not hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword, nothing can separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ our Lord. Thanks be to God. Now let us affirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Clothe your ministers with righteousness. Let your people sing with joy. Give peace, O Lord, in all the world, for only in you can we live in safety. Lord, keep this nation under your care and guide us in the way of justice and truth. Let your way be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations. Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten, nor the hope of the poor be taken away. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and sustain us by your Holy Spirit. O God, the protector of all who trust in you, without whom nothing is strong, nothing is holy, increase and multiply upon us your mercy, that with you as our ruler and guide, we may so pass through things temporal that we lose not things eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. O God, you make us glad with the weekly remembrance of the glorious resurrection of your Son, our Lord. Give us this day such blessing through our worship of you, that the week to come may be spent in your favor, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Heavenly Father, in you we live and move and have our being. We humbly pray you so to guide and govern us by your Holy Spirit, that in all the cares and occupations of our lives, we may not forget you, but may remember that we are ever walking in your sight. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O God, you have made of one blood all the peoples of the earth, and sent your blessed Son to preach peace to those who are far off and to those who are near. Grant that people everywhere may seek after you and find you. Bring the nations into your fold. Pour out your Spirit upon all flesh and hasten the coming of your kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, we pray today especially for those ill or distressed, for Brevi and Kathy, Sherry, John, Danny, John Will, Gary, Kathleen, Alyssa, Deborah, Clifton, Nancy, Brad Mack, Tommy and family, Alan, Jim, Richard, Carolyn and Wayne, John, Jonathan, Laney, Mike, and Cindy. We give thanks for those celebrating birthdays this week, for Anna Olivia Reed, Jessica Lawrence, Shannon Haston, Joe Gerlach, and Becky Bridges. Watch over these your children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts may your peace, which passes understanding, abide all the days of their lives, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I'd like to take just a minute to welcome you to St. Luke's and thank you for joining us. We worship together online right now during the pandemic, as most churches are doing. And we invite you to continue to come back and worship with us. Sometimes we're doing outdoor services as well, but stay tuned to our website and grab our newsletter there on the website, and you can find all the information there. Thank you to all of those who participated in putting this week's service together. Happy birthday to so many people this week. I hope you have a COVID birthday. I hope you have a nice celebration with those who are close to you. One more congratulations to our senior class who finally got to celebrate their graduation this week. As we here at St. Luke's are a part of the big family of God, you know that you're always part of this family, and we send you our love. Summer book groups have ended now, but there is more Christian education to come. Please stay tuned and watch the website for a new book that we're going to be starting here at the end of August, and some newsletter about some Christian Sunday school classes coming up. You've probably already heard that our bishop has continued our suspension of indoor person-to-person, in-person worship for now until August 15th. I think that's wise, and I think that we know that since the virus here in Alabama, we continue to struggle with it. It's important for us to take care of one another and to be thinking about all of the healthcare workers who are dealing with this crisis right now. They need us to take care as much as those vulnerable to infection need us to take care and to wear our masks and to stay at home as much as we can. All of my meetings continue to take place online, which means less travel time, which is good, and less expense. This coming week, I have a clericus meeting, which is just short for a meeting of all the clergy in the Mountain Convocation. Look forward to getting together with them via Zoom. I'll give them your best from here at the lake. The Mountain Lakes Chamber of Commerce is putting together, by the way, a short video to encourage all of us in this community to take care of one another. And this will be in honor of all the healthcare professionals in this town, especially those at Highlands. Yours truly is taking place in that. It'll be a short little thing, so be on the lookout for that coming soon. Now I'd like to offer a prayer for all the gifts that have come this week. Almighty God, we present to you these gifts and pray that you will bless our work here at St. Luke's in mission and in ministry as we serve this community and the world. Grant us grateful hearts and prayerful spirits. Help us to labor diligently and give generously to make known the power of your love given through Jesus Christ. Let us not forget the lessons from the past, nor fear the challenges of this time. Anoint us with your grace and shine in our hearts as we reflect your light throughout the world. Amen. And now we continue our service with a general thanksgiving. Please join me. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all, for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts, we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.